start the conversation, because you're going to, you've got two provocative questions or issues to address, whichever one suits you, and you can go off on a tangent all of your own to add variety as well. So we'll be listening with interest, and then it'd be nice to be able to have time to come back and look at what all of you have said to say, so what are some questions we could ask here, or what are some ideas or aha moments we have from listening to you? So, thank you, and we have a very diverse panel. There's Kirsten Ross and Romana there. Yeah, hi. So Kirsten reminds me that we had a relationship of teacher and learner way back, which is lovely.
10 years ago.
Yes, 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 it would be. And Nick Rodder.
Hello.
It's Nick. Yeah, and Paige Deneen. I'm sorry if I'm mispronouncing any of this. And Danica Miller.
Yeah.
Right. And Rachel Keeler. Is that right?
Yep.
Oh, good. Kilo.
Kilo, yep.
Yes, great. And Jeff Johnson.
Yes.
Hi. And you're a unique person on this panel.
I think I might be outnumbered.
Yeah. I think of the power. Uniqueness. Michael Charles and Rick Van Versick, who've come all the way from Portland, Oregon to be here today. So I think travelled the longest distance. Pacific University. And Sam Pierce, you've got rather a unique role here as well today too, from establishing university partnerships. You've got knowledge there that a lot would love to suck out of your brain. And Shaney, that we've already heard as well. So I think we might start. Is that all right with you?
It's fine,
and I'll
yeah.
just use my finger of fate here and press. Oops, I'm hitting myself. And would you like to stand up or talk from here?
Oh, if you can hear me, I'll sit down if you'll. That's okay. I was just trying to think. So I'm Jeff Johnson. I'm the manager for the exploration team for Symek Mining, which is the old REM, the Whyalla based mining and steel company. I'm a geologist, environmental scientist as well, but my function is geology. We've got a team of 15 people. So we've been involved in the program for 2 years and we'll be continuing this year. And what motivated us, I was just trying to think of an example, and I've got a good one because we've been recruiting in the quite recent past. So we advertised for a geologist. And geology, most people would be aware, is physics, chemistry, to a lesser degree, biology, botany, most of the sciences in application. And we're basically, well, we're sort of like forensic scientists. We're gathering clues about where mineralisation might be and trying to target from a very large area down to quite a small area before we go into the expensive stuff. So we're looking for science graduates, particularly. And when we recruited recently, we had 200 applications. And first pass screening, literally in a pile, whether it be paper or digital, about that thick. And we have to make a fairly quick short list, long list. So basically, we've got 30 seconds per application, roughly, unless it's an interesting one, and then we'll linger. So we look at, first of all, is the person eligible to work in Australia? Pretty fundamental. Do they have a degree? And then what is the degree? So where we, and you get quite good at this after a while. So we finish up with our long list, if you like. And then we want to see people who've got fundamental basic science training, preferably physics, maths, chemistry, and one of the biology botanies as well. What we find a lot is, what we do apart from science is a lot of conceptual and abstract thinking as well. So we tend to get a lot of people who have done degrees that, depending on which uni you went to, have got a bit of a hybrid, some humanities, some science. And almost invariably, those people end up on the no list as we're after. Science, science, science. And we find that the conceptual and abstract and research skills come in the fourth year when they do an honours degree. So We very strongly support anything that can enthuse high school students, because you want people to do maths, physics, chemistry, etc. at uni. They've got to be fired up at high school, we generally think. And so we've got 12 geologists, and every single one of them has been chosen because they've got a really strong basic science background. So we're really pleased to be able to assist and give some practical examples of just things that we face every day that might help the students, student teachers, put their lessons together to really enthuse the kids and hopefully get them to uni and hopefully do a massive amount of science. So they're the ones that we find the most employable. So I don't know where I am on the timing, but that's what I really wanted to just emphasise, that what you do in your education roles is so important to employers 3 or 4 years down there, or 5 or 6 or whatever it is down the track.
Well timed, and thank you.
Thank you.
I was actually thinking when you were talking, really, in the balance of interests, we should have probably given you double time.
No.
We'll probably ask some good questions later on. So thank you for that.
Okay, so when I was part of this program, I was lecturing in IT here at Tonsley, and I'm now moved into practical application in our IT support department dealing with researchers. And when I was invited to be on the panel, I was thinking, okay, so my involvement was on sessions with education students, and I was advising them on STEM. So I was thinking about, you know, what role did it help, did it help STEM, basically, because STEM's my background. I think the thing that struck me when I was talking to the education students about their various projects was how much it enabled them to understand the practical application of STEM. They're not STEM students. They're not trying to get STEM degrees, and that had been my experience, was dealing with students who were focused on STEM. So it was really interesting to deal with students who were looking at STEM from a practical application. How could they take STEM and use it to advance something? How could they take STEM and use it to interest others in what they were doing? And I think it was one of the most rewarding sessions I've been involved with, because they'd all come at different problems and tried to bring STEM into it from an understanding of the problem and then applying STEM. STEM students look at STEM and then find a problem to apply it to. There's a real STEM focus. So I think what would be really valuable is the fact that they then take that out back into their teaching. They take an understanding of applied STEM. Now, is there anybody here who doesn't have a smartphone? Okay, is there anybody here who doesn't have a computer? Is there anyone here who doesn't use computers in any walk of their life? And the answer is, of course, no. Whether you choose to or not, we're all using STEM on a daily basis. And so taking that, not only that understanding of STEM, but the demystification and the practical application of STEM, I think was probably one of the most valuable things that they would be doing with this program. And they'd be able to weave that into lessons in really diverse ways then. It doesn't, you know, they could be teaching any topic, and STEM could just be naturally woven in, the same as it is in everybody's lives. I imagine very few of you stop every time you use your phone and think, wow, look at this computing device. It's got amazing RAM. What great graphics are in this? You just go, phone call, answer the phone. And that's really what they gained from this program. Not so much a, wow, STEM is so sexy and look at the RAM involved. They took back practical application of STEM, and now they can weave it in whatever way they want, because they've got an understanding of the use of STEM. If they were STEM students, I'd want them to understand how STEM worked. But this program provided application STEM, and I think really that's the most valuable thing you can give students nowadays, because there isn't a student that isn't going to be graduating at any level that is not going to be using STEM in some way in their daily lives, now and in the future. It's just a reality. So that was actually how I thought of it.
Yeah,
that makes your time.
I actually have to confess that I forgot to turn it on.
I was thinking I was doing so well.
No, I think you were just right. So I will remember this time, and if we can move on to you now, Kirsten.
Right, I made notes in another time. Yeah.
Hashtag my list.
So my name's Kirsten Ross. I'm a researcher in environmental health. So I look primarily at a gastrointestinal worm that affects Aboriginal Australian population. So I'm a pure researcher. I'll just give you a bit of an overview of what I did, my involvement, and then talk a little bit about this, my observations. So I went to the initial round robin, which was a round table discussion. I think it was actually here in this room, with about 10 groups of students and about 10 researchers. And the students sat with us and presented their ideas. And then we, as scientists, approached the problem like we would with our PhD students. All right, what does the literature have to say about your problem? What holes can you see? Really, how you're showing us that there is a gap? What's the hypothesis? How do you test this hypothesis? What are the controls? What are the reference data? What are all those sorts of things that you need as a scientist to address that really underpin how an idea is actually taken and addressed? So that was the first stage that of my involvement. The second stage was that one group of two students then came directly to me to ask me whether I would accompany them on their journey with the host. So I met with their host and them as they initially presented their idea, had an initial discussion with the host, and then I went for their final presentation. And in the interim, we had a few brief chats over the email and maybe one or two phone calls. So my involvement was really limited primarily to that first discussion, where we were just asked to look at the problem as we would as research scientists. So what did I observe? The students were incredibly clever. That was the first thing. They were really clever, they were really engaged, and they were really enthusiastic. Now, I love students anyway, but these students were incredibly engaged. They were very ready to consider these scientific criticisms that we were giving them, because we were probably, scientists are harsh. That's how we work, is we criticise one another. That's how science works. That's what makes science good. But having your ideas pulled apart and criticised can be quite confronting, but the students were right up for that. They really wanted to get into those discussions. They were really good at pulling together the knowledge that they had, company requirements, and that scientific criticism that we gave them. So my experience of it was that it's such a terrific approach, in that it pulls together all of these different components and makes something far more valuable than the sum of the parts. Thanks.
Do you have another minute and 19 seconds to do something?
I don't
15.
Know.
Okay.
That's enough.
Right,
for me.
Good, thank you.
So I'm Danica. I'm a fourth year education student with a double major in maths and biology. So for me, I got approached by Carol about joining in on the program, and I have to admit my first thing was STEM, of course, it's going to look great on my resume, let's get involved. And I then kind of sat back and went, well, actually, what benefit is my students going to get out of me undertaking this process? Because it was extra work, it was an extra time commitment. And it kind of sat back and said, I want to avoid that question in class of, but miss, when am I going to use this? I think it's the most common question I get when teaching maths in particular, more so than biology. And for me, anything that I can do to then make it more relatable for students is obviously going to be beneficial to their engagement and get them into careers in STEM, because we've all said that's where workforce is going. So being a student who went straight from graduating school in 2014 into university, I haven't been out in industries. I haven't had a past career to kind of pull in ideas from to make it more relatable in the classroom. So going out to a mining company, so we actually, Rachel and myself, went to Simic Mining. And so for us, we then got to see where they're using it, so that when we give an example in the classroom of maths, we're not using the pretend real world examples, I call them, of like, there's a shadow on a tree and let's calculate the hypotenuse and things like that. We actually can say, no, they use that. They use trigonometry when they're looking at the angles in which they are drilling into the ground. And all of a sudden, it kind of brought about more than a line on my resume, but I actually can be a better teacher because I now have an experience that I can directly draw on in my classroom, and not just in maths, but in biology. Seeing, I guess there's a stigma, and some biologists would say, oh, we don't want mining, but we actually got to see how they're using biology and ecology understanding in the mining industry. Again, something that can be drawn on in the classroom to make my lessons more engaging and to make students more interested and passionate about science, because really that's what we're there to do. So, yeah.
Thank you. Very succinct. And if you don't want to use your 1 minute and 40 seconds.
No,
beautiful. Hi, I'm Paige Deneen. I'm a second year master's student at Flinders University, as well as Danica and Nick and Rachel. Again, I was approached by Carol last year in our science curriculum class to undertake the Bridging the Gap. At first, I was very sceptical about the process. I didn't realise what the benefits of undertaking this extra work could do, but after visiting our industry, Nick and I were partners. We went to SA Power Network, and learning about the application of physics and chemistry and everything that they're doing and how that industry actually works was, first of all, very, very motivating. And they presented us with problems that were extremely difficult to address, as they're very futuristic problems. We personally tackled what we could do about electric cars and how we could kind of incorporate a business structure in order to make electric cars a feasible possibility for the Adelaide population in about 30 years. So stretching our minds with that, using a lot of the beautiful, amazing, lovely Romana and her ICT background, we developed an awesome idea, I believe, about what we could do. The Bridging the Gap kind of program was really beneficial personally for me, because again, just like Danica said, you can really see how, first of all, industry actually works here in Adelaide, and then apply that with enthusiasm from your own perspective rather than trying to draw from it from a not very, you know, because it's a personal experience that you've now had, and you can give that to your students now. And like, even though I went to SA Power Networks, you could still see that there are aspects of all of the sciences coming together. There's a lot of biology in that as well. Even though it's very physics driven, you've still got environmental factors that they have to deal with. You've still got all of these things that are coming together and making that industry work, and trying to get that message across to us, and now we can give that message to our students, is such a beneficial experience, and I'm very glad I was a part of it. Thank you.
Thank you. Well done. You also have 1 minute.
Well, we're really working to the 3 minute original times.
No, well, you know, gave us three.
We have this 3 minute thesis, as I said, in the university. It does really actually make people home to what's really important, and you're doing a great job. Sam, I'm really interested to hear what you've got to say.
So I'm Sam Pearce, and until recently I worked with the Department of Education and Child Development as a business partnership manager. And I had a fairly open role, and that was to go out and do good things with schools and industry. So I had the great privilege the last 3 years working with a group of schools in the south, and I felt like we were on a journey together of discovering, you know, how can we do this and what good can come from it. So I learned quite a lot. And for me, this project, there was a quote from one of the pre-service teachers up on the screen there before, which is everything I hoped would come from it, beyond the great data that you're getting on PISA results. But one of the students says, she said, "I know now that I can reach out to industry and develop authentic learning, and I reckon that is the key of the teacher and the teacher's practice. If we can have pre-service teachers going out with that kind of thinking, then when the time is right, they will reach out to industry to produce authentic learning." So I started working with a group of schools. I said, "Here I am, I'm a resource. I can help make connections with industry. What should we do?" And this group of schools, there was a common theme with them, and that was that they wanted to do things differently. They didn't want to do what they've always been doing. They wanted to try different things. They had a view of STEM that it wasn't just more science, more technology, etc., etc. And they also wanted to, as I said before, develop authentic learning, so that they wanted to make it real. They wanted to have the real world in their classroom. So we went on a journey of looking at what can industry bring to those objectives. And they wanted to, you know, they wanted to take their students from that question that comes out, why do I need to know this, to students who say, I can see myself in this. And that goes back to the disposition data, where we know in Australia that we've got reasonable STEM science knowledge in students, and they even have able to articulate the importance of science and STEM in society, but they don't see themselves in it. So how do we change that? And that was sort of the part of the journey that we went on. So long story short, but there was a gravitation towards, we want to develop STEM skills, critical and creative thinking, problem solving. And a lot of the schools at the time were moving into problem-based learning, project-based learning, and they were coming up, they were making up problems or pulling problems off the web, you know, that they could put in front of students. They said, what if we got real problems from real people? Maybe that'll have an impact on how young people view STEM. So my role really was to work with the school, the particular teacher, and we're talking from a teacher saying, I want to do things differently in my classroom, to a whole school saying, we want to do holus bolus, we want to do it differently. So it started with some professional learning that we did with the ASMS, but we also did some with the New Venture Institute around what is this world of problem solving. And the layer I was putting on it was, let's get some real problems with some real people. So I ended up working with Travis at Ranella. And Ranella's a great example, you know, early stages. I helped them ignite some relationships with a couple of different industries. And now they just do it on their own, and it's just what they do, because that's how they teach. They go and find authenticity. And that's great. That's, you know, job done. Off I go. We also worked with Wollonga and the Wollonga Water Basin. So a lot of it was around a problem that we asked industry to identify for us, much the same as what the in-service teachers were doing. But, you know, the layer of that was we asked the industry people to present that to students, be part of the the ideation process, where students were coming up with solutions and also hearing the solutions at the end. And that really clicked with industry. You know, the many of the ones that I dealt with, and I worked with a lot of food ones, so Hague's and Jurlik and Beerenberg and Zong Engineering, Fulton Hogan, a whole range of them. It struck a chord with them because they only know what they know, and when they're working with schools, often they're asked to come in and be a speaker. I'm an engineer, I do this. And for some students, they'll connect with that, and that will change their disposition towards that subject and alter their career path. But for kids who want to touch and feel and experience, when someone from industry can come in and present them with a challenge, a problem that they can work on and come up with a solution, that they're doing it. So we had classes of kids working on solving a real problem presented by industry, you know, coming up with solutions, trying them out, failing, redoing them, coming up with a pitch at the end. And those students were working for that company, in a sense, and experienced what it's like to be a scientist, an engineer, etc., etc., but not leave the classroom. And when I talked to kids, that wasn't a deal breaker. So I worked with some industries and some schools, and the schools never went and saw the industry, necessarily. But the person coming in with a real problem, they could change the whole dynamic of the learning, in a sense, because it wasn't a teacher and it was a real problem, and they felt responsibility and investment in that, solving that problem. So some of the ideas were great. So
we have to catch it off there. Do you want to finish off that idea? We've gone over time. I've given you 2 extra minutes.
I've
there,
one
I
guess.
Yeah, I had spare.
And I have some questions I want to ask you later, so you can come back, Sam. That's really, I'm sorry cutting you off, but really interesting, and it is a unique view in this classroom, in this group now. Thank you.
Okay, so hello, I'm Rachel. I am a pre-service teacher at Flinders. I'm in my final year this year, which is very exciting. And like the other pre-service teachers here, I went to my science curriculum specialisation topic with Carol, and we had the opportunity to go into this program. I was very glad that we did get to have that experience. Danica and I, as she said before, we went to SciMec with Jeff, and we talked about all the different types of science used there and how we can help our students develop those skills that will be useful in industries just like SciMec. So for our problem, ours was more education based, and it was about how we can help students develop those skills and how we can create engaging tasks to promote students' interests in that sort of field. So we made activities and a unit plan and lesson plans and stuff for teaching about mining in the classroom, and incorporated all those different types of STEM in that. So we had ecology tasks for the biology aspect. We had the magnetic mapping sort of tasks for the physics, and each for chemistry, and also maths related tasks with financial maths and things like that. So that was really, really beneficial to use real world examples and real world sort of contexts for student learning. So getting them to move away from asking the questions, when will I ever need to know this formula, or when will I ever need to know what that does in a cell? These were sort of more authentic links that we could actually make, instead of those maths problems that say, Johnny bought 17 oranges and whatever, that are very unrealistic. This is something that we can definitely take back into the classroom and be meaningful for students.
Thank you very much. Right, now, Rick, having flown all the way here only, what, 4 or 5 days ago, 4 days?
About that, five days ago. And we're going to save you even a little bit more time, because Mike and I are going to condense our presentation into just 1 4-minute session
okay.
here. So.
But it's a challenge.
My name is Rich Van Buskirk. I'm from Pacific University in Oregon, and I'm going to talk to you today a little bit and provide some context for some of the work we've been doing with some of the secondary schools in our region, and then Mike's going to provide some of the sexy graphics. So a lot of that kind of dynamic going here. I'm going to tell you a little bit about a tool, actually, that's used pretty widely in industry and business, rather than a particular industry, and that tool is GIS, or Geographic Information Systems. And I know many of you are familiar with that, but for those of you who aren't, it's basically just a way of working with data that has a spatial component. And it's kind of neat, because whether you're working with rail lines and where the trains are and the schedules and such, navigation sorts of things, where you want to put your next Woolworths, how you want to reach your voters for a political campaign, understanding where those bits and pieces of information are relative to one another is key. And the reason this works so well in an educational setting is that it allows students to work in a number of disciplines and think about problems spatially. And we can't lay claim to originating this approach. This actually builds off a program that was started at James Madison University in Virginia in the United States. And they were searching for a way to engage students who were in their final year, who were seniors, who had done the college applications, they're all set and kind of coasting. And they thought, if we can get them engaged with projects and really bring project-based learning back to the classroom, we could do that. And hey, why don't we take this tool that's used widely in the professions and teach them how to use that tool? And not only does that give them a powerful piece of software to master as they ask questions that have a spatial component, but it also means that they are working with local data and addressing local problems. And so that was really the big kicker there. They could think about things that were close to their own hearts. So we took off with that and implemented that in Oregon through a program we're calling the Pacific Geospatial Semester. And we do this in a mentored dual enrollment program where we work with faculty at the secondary schools who are interested in learning a new tool and a new approach in any one of a number of disciplines. We provide support to that. We visit the classrooms, we talk with the students, we help them engage with projects. And those students can earn university credit while they're taking their classes there in high school. So it's really been kind of a neat thing. And what I've tried to do really is we talked about giving students access to real world problems. One of my biggest tasks with working with those faculty is helping them to understand where data lies and how they can access data that's used by lots of different entities in our region and bring that real world information to problems they want to address, sometimes even helping them solve problems in the process. In fact, I believe we're going to be taking on an issue of network access within the school system and where fiber optic lines are laid, and trying to get some students to look at that to help the school system as it plans for expansion of access to data. And we brought some examples here. Mike, I'm going to let you talk about those.
And this bridge the gap between that has been the theme all the way through. If Travis, for example, is going to do this in his classroom, and his teacher in the secondary school who's doing it, he really needs somebody like Rich who knows the professional grade tool. That's what bridging the gap looks like, because the tool isn't that easy. What does the work actually look like? Well, there's an example up on the board on the screen. So that's a map that shows how population changed in Germany over a 20-year time period. Remember he said local data? This doesn't really sound like local data since we live in Oregon, but this is an international student at our local high school, and this was local data for her. This is her life. This is what's happened in her lifetime, is the population has changed. So what do you notice? Red means it's going down, green means it's going up. No, you're not allowed to read her conclusion, it's brilliant. But what do you notice from the data?
Migration.
What kind of migration? What are you noticing?
There's a movement towards a centralized area. So if green is high density,
yep,
and red is lessening density, the assumption is that's moving.
So that's called Berlin, and that's where people have been moving to. And this is called East Germany, and that's where they've been moving out of. And that's where she's from.
Thanks. My alarm in the morning. I've hit the wrong thing. I do apologize. Keep going.
Do I have anything more I want to say about this? That when questions came up, we'll use Travis as an example once again. If Travis's actual name is Scott, he's at a high school in Oregon, and how to bring, this is a really cool map. Here's the thing, she gathered the data. She posed the question, she gathered the data, and she made the map with professional grade software. And when Travis got stuck in helping her doing that, Travis sent an email to Rich. The subject line said, help! And Travis knew we'd come, we'd support. And the number of secondary students who are doing this in the United States right now, the correct unit on that is hundreds, not just a few. And the time frame, over 10 years. I don't mean hundreds over 10 years, I mean 100 today. But it's been running for 10 years. We've been going across this bridge for a while, and it hadn't broken yet.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. I do apologize for my, apparently it was a phone call coming in that disrupted us. My phone doesn't normally ring that way, so I do apologize.
That's right.
I'm sure we'll come back to you with some more questions. Okay.
My name's Nick. I'm a fourth year student at Flinders as well. I'm doing studying science, so chemistry and maths and physics as a minor as well. Hopefully we'll squeeze in music there too, add the steam in. But I went together with Paige to SA Power Networks, which was really good. Before that though, coming right back, I had no experience with STEM. It had all been separated. Every single subject was different, and science was separate to maths. And we used maths in science, but everybody was like, oh no, not maths in this science topic. Why can't we just stick to the science? And then engineering and technology was just never really a part of it. So this was a brand new thing for me, and I'm very glad I discovered it, the chance to incorporate everything together. So we went, try not to cover the same stuff you did, we went together to SA Power Networks. First things first, we went to a training depot where they have substations and power hubs where they train all their electricians and those sort of people on there. And we got to tour that place together. Then we went into the city a bit further to the Innovation Center, where we got to have a look at the future of the power at the moment, what they're developing, the stuff that they're putting on each single power line to track exactly how the current's going and redirect current and power in our grid. I also talked about the new batteries that we're having on our houses and the electric cars and the future of that and how that's going to look down the line. So incorporating physics, incorporating maths, incorporating chemistry, trying to get power lines through trees and cutting down trees and where to cut down trees and the biology and geography and everything's in there all at once. And then we got given some questions to look at. They'd already come up with some questions for us, particularly relevant to them. Some of that they'd already solved, which was really cool. Mm-hmm. Last year they had some students come along, still part of the Bridging the Gap project, students come along and try solve those problems that they'd already solved and then compare what their solution was, the industry solution, against what the kids did. And they were surprisingly close, and I've heard so much positive stuff back from them because they're very impressed with the kids and how far they got and the creative ideas that came out of that. Then they had some problems that they hadn't approached yet. They were still working on electric vehicles and how that was looking in the future. That's what Paige and I looked into. We gave a kind of presentation on that for them. And so we kind of went through what the students would go through if we took our students back there, which we plan on doing. Well, I think we both do, cool. This year or next year, taking them back on an excursion to just see, get them involved out of school at an excursion. But the really cool thing is they've decided that they would like to be a part of that too, and they're going to come into the school for us and have a look at some of the projects that they create and assess them, be like a panel like they've got here, and more importantly take those ideas and actually possibly apply them in their own industry. Because I was just stunned to hear that they were amazed by the creativity of the kids and the possibility to apply the ideas from these young kids that have like no experience in STEM normally. They're taking stuff from all the different areas and possibilities that they can apply to themselves. I think that was it.
Oh, quick. 17 seconds left.
There's nothing else, sorry.
Thank you very much. Right, so Shane, lucky last.
Okay, so how does my perspective connect with Bridging the Gap? Well, I know I separated them before when I was talking to you, but of course STEM fits perfectly into your PARS. It's just four of the subjects that we're offering in schools. And I think one of the challenges we have is exactly the same challenge that we get with interdisciplinary teaching and learning, and it's that we're bringing innovation into schools. And one of the really interesting things that came out of the research that I was doing wasn't the fact that we came up with a framework, that was great, but the really interesting stuff was finding out the enablers and barriers that exist to innovation in schools. Because there are a lot of great ideas out there, whether it be STEM, whether it be interdisciplinary, whether it be anything else, and yet we get into schools and the two greatest barriers are timetables and assessment. And that's what we are all organised by, and it's what we are held accountable to. And I think from my conversations, I find that teachers really want to be innovative as long as we're making sure that we're hitting out accountabilities first. So I think that there's another gap bridging effort that needs to go on there. It's one of the things we attempted to do with the research, was to say, okay, we want to bring in innovation, how about we see if we can do it by making sure our accountabilities and our timetabling restrictions are covered at the same time. So one avenue is looking at resourcing. I think there's been a lot of ideas shared today about resourcing and a lot of the ideas that are already happening in schools. We've got a lot of anecdotal evidence about what we can do. But I think, as with the interdisciplinary, STEM initiatives also need some robust assessment, because the question is, how do we know that what we've implemented is working? How do we know that we're planning well, that we're teaching well? How do we know that the students have learnt what was intended? Have they learnt something else? And is that something else equally fantastic? But how do we know? One of the issues that came out of the interdisciplinary study was that often initiatives like this happen in schools. We put STEM together, but when we come to assessment, often it gets deintegrated again. So the science teacher marks the science bit, the maths teacher marks the maths bit. That's okay, because it's really important to have that disciplinary grounding. It's really important to have that assessed and acknowledged. But we also need to say, okay, what about the value added? What about the synergy that we're all talking about that happens when we integrate disciplines? How about we try and capture that as well? So that's another thing that's been really, really important in this space. And I think it can help bridging the gap. That's me.
Yes.
Good.
50 seconds left. I don't know if you want to guide me here, but I just suspect that there may be some people sitting here that have had an aha moment or a yes, but kind of question happening as you've all listened to the biggest panel in the Southern Hemisphere. So is anybody sitting on an aha or a question or an observation?
I've got one. Can I have one?
Sure, absolutely.
As a STEM educator, one of the difficulties I can see with the assessment thing, as listening to you, is it's all very well for us to come and say, look, here's STEM, great, now you embrace it, you take these real life projects back, that's terrific. I think we also need to be aware that if we're doing that, we should help with these are the objectives that should be measured and how they should be measured. And actually not just stop at the bit where the assessment happens. And I think it's really, it's easy as an educator myself to go, yeah, okay, that needs to happen. But we need to bring industry along on that journey and say, well, how would you define success? How would you go, well, that project worked or that project didn't work? What are the outcomes you're expecting? And then, you know, when you're talking about the value added bit, that's the value added bit. That's the synergy bit. And perhaps that is a bit of a facile answer, but it seems like one of the easiest approaches, perhaps.
And as Janie would say, she'd know where I'd jump in here, is that I think one of the problems with all of this is that we are forced to measure,
yes,
rather than to assess. And I think there is a lot to be said, what we talked earlier about wisdom of practice and professional wisdom, professional judgment, that there are qualities that we're looking for that perhaps can't be measured per se, but we can observe them and we can describe them, which make them much more meaningful, because a measurement is only a measurement,
sure,
once you've given it a meaning.
Yeah.
And the problem is we talk so much and we hear so much and pushed by measurement, and parents and school and departments all look for easily
Matrix.
Arrived at numbers that they give different meanings to. And we often don't specify the meaning, but described, the description of what it means to, you know, do STEM,
yes,
in such a way that it's observable. Like Hattie talks about visible learning,
mm-hmm,
and that visibility isn't in a number, it's in us being able to articulate it.
So in several of my topics, I removed exams because they were measurable, assessable pieces.
Mm.
But they weren't necessarily anything that a regurgitation exercise. They weren't interpretation.
Mm-hmm.
So what I wanted to measure was how much they'd understood, so that they could interpret, so I'd get industry judges in,
mm-hmm,
which is basically what we're doing here. And I'd say, now, you've got a company that you need to build a solution based around what you've learned for. Now present it,
mm-hmm,
as if you were presenting a contract. You're all bidding for the same contract. Now, why should your company get the bid? And that allowed them to demonstrate, and they were then, there was still measurement, but it was a measurement of understanding, as
mm.
opposed to, you know, you've ticked this box.
Mm.
You know, but it took some time to,
yeah,
evolve that, and you
mm.
need to make sure you're resourced and supported, and that you've got the industry people ready to come, and you know, you've got the support to do that. So it's easy to say this is a great way to do it, but I also recognise the inherent difficulties.
Mm-hmm. Very good, thank you. Yes?
Just a bit of an extension of this idea, we all have to develop like the general capabilities from the Australian curriculum in all of our subject mm-hmm. areas, and that's one of those things. It's like, how can you measure student success in those areas mm-hmm. which are really important and which are really like employable skills? So mm-hmm. it's difficult. Mm-hmm. And I think, yeah, we have to move away from that you know, the A to E grade in a subject area, and what's the value of these capabilities, and what sort of understanding are the kids showing, or skill set they're showing within those capabilities.
It's interesting that some of the IT industries, like the Big Four, are actually dropping university qualifications. Mm. And a lot of them have been doing online tests and things, and they're starting to move away from that and doing interviews. They do video interviews now, mm. and they give them a set of questions instead of the just right, tick this box, tick this box, tick this box. And they're finding they're getting better results from that. You know, they prefer a uni degree because it gives them a baseline. But if the interview is really good, why let that hold you back? So it's about these different ways we measure employability.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Another contentious term.
I think one of the questions in our system of education is, whilst we have an accountability at the end of Year 12, we are struggling to move in the education system into a space where integrating knowledge and demonstrating the level of understanding they have doesn't come down to a point score, doesn't come down to how well they do in their exams, and therefore how easily they get into university based on that. So there's a bigger picture problem that we have. And we have teachers that are willing to play in this space. And we have teachers and we have young people coming through that are willing to play in that space. But we have to shift our system, and we have to shift that accountability at the end of Year 12 to, and we know in the media that it's showing that, you know, Year 12 scores are not everything. But whilst it takes a score to get to university, or a score, as you're saying, we have to play by those rules, and we have to break that cycle. And maybe that might happen in the SACE board in the next few years, is what we're all hoping, with where we're sitting now with our current CEO of the SACE board. But we need that to change, to really allow our teachers to really play well in that space. I went to Australian Maths and Science School last year. Year 12 was still run very much the same way because they have to meet that standard.
Yes.
We want to change. We need that ability to change, I think, comes with it.
And change ministers and the population and all that.
There's a lot of, and even a parent expectation of, you can't give my child feedback, I need a grade to see how well they went. And that's all part of it.
I've got to be honest, you know, having seen the kids that come into uni, the ones that come in through other paths and just the SACE path, and seeing kids who come in with very high grades, often they're the higher grade ones are the ones who struggle the most.
Absolutely.
Well, isn't it Flinders that I read recently? Was saying that the greatest predictor of success at Flinders University for students, not success getting into their course, but success at university, is their performance and research project.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Creativity. It's all about problem solving skills and creativity.
And self-regulation of learning.
Yeah.
And the biggest measure of their capacity to do something is students that can be taught to regulate their learning. I'm really conscious that this is a wonderful conversation. No, please don't apologise. It's great. And I wanted to ask you some things about, I loved hearing your statement about people wanting to do things differently is what you're talking about. But I think we've run out of time and there's some things to wind up. So all I can do is thank you all for your contribution. There have been pearls of wisdom, great gems. I've made some notes here. And I hope this is not the end of the conversation that we're going to have. Because I think it's the conversations for us that actually helps us to start regulating what we do as people involved in preparing the next generation of the workforce and of society and the community, which is STEAM, really. Yeah. So thank you very much, panel. You did a great job.
Thank you.